Boy, got quiet in here, huh?
Yes.
Okay, so my name is Joe Rakowski. I'm a member of the school building committee. On behalf of the school building committee, I want to welcome you all here tonight to this information session. And this is being filmed. This is an open meeting, so it is being filmed. It will be aired on either Channel 12 or
15.
Channel 15. Channel 15. So I want to welcome those individuals who are going to see this on Channel 15 a little bit later in the week. So tonight is the third installment of information sessions that we have pushed out to the town. We did our first one on November 20th for town leaders, and it was open to the public. We did that over at West Street School. We also gave a brief update at the spring town leadership meeting on April 27th. And again, that was for town leaders, and it was open to the public. And tonight is our third session, and I got to tell you, we as a committee, we are really excited because we've been at this for 14 months now. A lot of hard work, sitting in dark, sweaty rooms, trying to come up with the best options and talk about different solutions. Tonight, we're excited because we're getting down to the point where we've got a preferred option. We want to share that with you. We hope you can pick up on that excitement too. The other thing I will tell you is we have made a commitment as a committee to continue these information sessions, hopefully on a quarterly basis. We're looking at the fall, September, October, as being the next time when we would get together, because there will be some significant events that are going to occur in the next several months, and we'll use the fall to update all of you on the status of the project. So as a school building committee, as I mentioned, we've been at this for 14 months. We've made some great progress. Tonight's session is designed to be about a one-hour meeting. We didn't want to have it here all night, so we tried to put together the right level of information to give you a nice status. We're prepared to be here for 5 hours if you have questions, so we'll do that. But we structured tonight to be roughly a one-hour meeting. I'm going to walk through the agenda here for tonight. If I can get this thing to work. So the agenda is we're going to do some intros. For those of you who didn't make prior sessions, we're going to do a quick introduction of the school building committee. Our chair, who's Mark Gale, is going to come up and talk about the goals of our committee and what we've been trying to accomplish here over the last 14 months. Our project team, which is seated here, is going to give you about a 20-minute status update on some of the options that have been considered and how we got to our preferred option. And then we're going to give you the rationale for our preferred option and then open it up to questions. And again, those questions can go on all night. By way of introductions, that's our Granby School Building Committee. We are working with the MSBA, which is the Massachusetts School Building Authority. They're actually helping us with the funding for this project. Colliers International is our project manager. And JWA Jones-Witset is our architect. So, School Building Committee, Mark Beal is here. John Libera is here somewhere. Jim Petras, Andrea Kennedy, Emery Everin, Lynn Mercier, Jim Morrissey, Ken Scully, Deb Barthelet, Jen Champagne, Dr. Judy Houle, and Chris Martin. I think that's our full committee. We did invite town leaders tonight. I know we have members from the school committee, the finance committee, the planning board, building inspector, the fire chief, the police chief. So again, we're trying to be as inclusive as possible. We sent invitations to the town leaders to get as many committee members here tonight to get them up to speed on what's happening. We've done that in the past too. Our project team, and I will tell you, we've got a great project team. Alan Minkus is with Collier. He's our project manager. Kristen Witset and Helen Fantini are both from JWA, and they've been great to work with over the last 7 months. So why don't we get right into our agenda. I'm going to introduce Mark Beal, who's our chairman of our school building committee, and then we're going to move right into this. Okay? Thank you.
Good evening. I don't have a real lot to say here, but I do want to kind of emphasize one thing tonight. One of the words associated with committee is commitment, and you're on a committee, often you feel like you should be committed in more ways than one. And tonight, I want to ask everybody in Granby to be committed to one thing, and that's keeping an open mind, at least until September. We're not going to make a decision about a school project until town meeting in February. And I think the best thing that we can do for our town right now is to keep an open mind. Okay? Eventually, some people are going to vote yes, some people are going to vote no, and that's what people do, that's what they're supposed to do. But we need time, town needs time, individuals need time to think about what the impact is of the school building and what the impact will be for the town and also for yourself. I know that my children will not attend this school. I know my mom attended Western. So, as Joe said, he introduced our committee here, and our committee's been working excellently. We have enough of a clash, so we actually have good discussions. We don't sit there and just everybody agree and kind of ratify the same decision. And we actually have been working pretty hard. I think sometimes we've got meetings that are like 3 hours long, which if you've been in a meeting, you really don't want to be in a meeting for 3 hours. And even as good as the people are that you're working with. So we've got one project for you tonight that will affect kids pre-K through six. And I think that you will be pleased by what we've come out with. It was not something that we just arrived at in a half an hour. Took a lot of time and a lot of thinking. And I got to say, we really did our due diligence in terms of looking at what our needs were and what we thought was best for most of the town. So Christian will present, Alan will present, and as Joe said, afterwards we'll answer questions.
Thank you. Again, my name is Alan Minkus. I'm with Colliers International. We've been hired as the OPM for the project. And the other important player, that besides Granby on this is the MSBA, Mass School Building Authority. They are a grant organization, and they have a lot of rules and restrictions for that grant money. So when you apply for your statement of interest, an SOI that went in probably a year and a half to 2 years ago, asking for project funds for the project, they put you into a queue, and then you got selected to be part of the process. But as the process goes along, there's a lot of boxes that have to be checked off that they want to make sure that everything's adhered to, because they have skin in the game. There's a lot of money they're going to put into this project, hopefully about 62 to 62.5% of the cost of this project, total cost of this project, will be borne by the taxpayers of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, not Granby alone, which is quite a bit of money. But in that process, we put together a little quick slide on the approval timeline that we've developed. Okay. Back in July, just about a year ago, we responded to a request for services for OPM, and the committee interviewed other OPMs, and we were selected as the OPM for the project. And then once we got hired, we put out an RFS, request for services, for the design team. And we looked at different designers and their qualifications, and that they've worked on projects similar to the Granby West Street School or the East Meadow School project. And that selection came back, and we sent that back to the MSBA, went up to Boston a couple times and had meetings with them to make that selection. And we were lucky enough that we had Jones Winstead Architects as the design team that got selected here, because they have very similar projects they've worked on in the past. And they're working on Plain School. Is it just down the road? Many familiar with it, but another elementary school, and they're doing a beautiful job on that as well. So they were hired in October of 2014. And once they got hired, then we started going into what's called, what's the program for the project? Okay, they had to start putting together the curriculum for the needs of the school. And that was submitted to the MSBA in January of this year. And again, MSBA takes it, they review it, they come back and they say, okay, this is, we agree with this program, it makes sense, it matches our educational specifications for Massachusetts schools, and we're on board with this. So they, MSBA got that, it's called a PDP, a preliminary design program, and that went in, like I said, in January. Since that point in time, then the design team started working on concepts, and it's not a schematic design just yet, but it's a feasibility study of, okay, do we do West Street? Do we do East Meadow? Do we do a new school on West Street? Do we do an additional remodel on West Street? Do we do a combination of additional remodel here on East Meadow? A whole lot of scenarios, and Kristen's going to go through those scenarios with, I think we had 7 solutions that came up. One of them being, what do we do if we just do a base repair to West Street? Don't do any addition, just bring it up to code. And so that's the baseline that MSBA looks for, and they judge. So in May, just last month, we finally came to a conclusion with the building committee as to the preferred solution that we want to put forward to the MSBA. That's going in on June 11th, so just in a few weeks or 10 days or so, we're submitting that. It's a pretty thick package that has to go in a lot of drawings and background information. Is going into the MSBA on the 11th. They will be reviewing it in a facilities assessment subcommittee called an FSA, and they will look at that and say that it makes sense or doesn't make sense. And we've done this before. We know it's going to make sense. They're going to see that it's probably the right solution for the town of Granby. Then they bring it to their board meeting. Their board meeting is coming up on July 27th, I believe it is, and vote on it. But it's pretty much a rubber stamp at that point in time, that once the facilities assessment subcommittee looks at it and sends it to the board, it's pretty much a guarantee that the board's going to bless it and move it forward. While that's going on, the designers are going to be working on schematic design, because this is such a protracted schedule for any project with them that we have to keep things moving regardless. So again, we said that July they're going to vote on it. And then by November of this coming year, we're going to have a full schematic design that's going to be done by the design team. And with that, we're going to have estimates done, one by the design team, one done by the OPM. We outsource it, we don't do it ourselves. We sit down and we reconcile those estimates, so there's a real gnashing of teeth and a full couple day session as to say, okay, we had a price of this for this and this for that, and we come to a resolution on what the cost for the schematic design will be. And it's only a schematic design at that point in time, but it's an important point in time, because that number goes to the MSBA on December 3rd with the schematic design solution, and they will then take that schematic design and that amount of money to their board meeting on January 27th of 2016. And that's the point in time where your grant is locked in. They will say, okay, we know it's a X amount of dollar project, we're on board with it, we're gonna contribute 62.6% of the state's money to it, and the rest is gonna have to be voted on by the town of Granby, whether they want to spend that money. So that's going to happen in January. We're going to get that information back that it was approved by the board of directors at the MSBA. We have a town meeting on February to tell you what those numbers are. We don't know right now. We're still working on concepts. So we'll get those numbers back. We'll have a vote on March 1st for those funds, for approval of those funds. And at that point in time, I'm telling you, this is a long process. That's when the architects start actually doing contract documents. They start doing the bid documents that have to be to go out to bid for the contractors to bid on the project. So again, some of the key dates that we're looking at coming up that already happened, January 16th, we put in the PDP, the preliminary design program. June 11th, right around the corner, first schematic design report. December 3rd, the schematic design. And then February, March, we're going to be looking for local funding approval from the taxpayers of Granby. Process, the full schedule that you can see here is, we are just finishing up on the yellow bar up there of the feasibility and schematic design. And here we're going to be putting forward to that December date. The MSBA board is going to review it on January 27th. The town is going to look at it and authorize it on March 1st, as we talked about. At that point in time, the design team needs 9 months to put together the contract documents for bidding. Again, the project is going to be over $10 million, so funding or for procurement laws in Massachusetts mean you have to go out for get file sub-bidders, and you have to get, and pre-qualify them, and you have pre-qualified general contractors as well. So we start doing that for you in October of 2016. That's typically about, takes about 3 months. We get a whole lot of people that want to bid on this project. We have to go through them and make sure that the type of people you want bidding on this project, that they're worthy of and honorable people to work with. And then we're going to put it out to bid, and the bids are going to be due in February, and we're going to award that bid in February of 2017. That's when construction is going to start. We're looking at this being an 18-month construction project. Toward the end of that project, there's going to be 3 months to put furniture, fixtures, and equipment into the school. And then we have, and so the occupancy date for the school to open would be the September of 2018. So we got a ways to go. And then we have closeout of the project, a closeout and commissioning of the project that's going to take us through the rest of 2018 to finish up of the project. So, and again, we have some of those key dates down here that you can read, but the process is quite lengthy. But again, it's because the state is contributing so much money. It's a grant type program, and they want to make sure that all the boxes are checked. Can't blame them. There's a lot of towns waiting for it to be in the grant program, and you've been selected, so we don't want to lose the opportunity. I'll turn it over to Kristen to talk about some of the concepts we've come up with.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you all for coming, volunteering your time on this day. When we were brought on board, the statement, as Alan mentioned, there's a statement of interest that was submitted to the Massachusetts School Building Authority by the district. That statement of interest was for the West Street School, which is currently a pre-K through 3 school. But when the MSBA looked at it, they wanted the town to evaluate both a pre-K through 3 option and a pre-K through 6 option, given the size of the district. Given that we looked at all the available sites in town, which basically narrowed down to 2, either the West Street site or the East Meadow site. Looking at the existing conditions of both buildings, that was kind of what we evaluated in that previous report that we submitted, the preliminary design program. Both schools are in similar shape. East Meadow is, you know, 20 years younger than West Street, so not showing quite as much wear, but similar issues with the building envelope, similar issues with accessibility, similar issues with the administration being both undersized and located in the center of the building, which has some sent some problems with day-to-day running of the building and security. All outdated mechanical plumbing, fire protection, there is no fire protection, electrical systems. And then we also looked at the sizes of the spaces you have now versus the MSBA guidelines of what schools should have in terms of new schools being developed in the state. So in both schools, the administration areas were very undersized compared to guidelines. The nurse suite, both gyms are less than half of what the MSBA typically sees. And then in West Street, the kitchen stage and pre-kindergarten classrooms were especially undersized. And in East Meadow, the library and music rooms were especially undersized. These are floor plans of West Street over here and East Meadow over here. You know, some pictures from West Street and East Meadow, but they share many of the same issues. So at West Street, there's unit ventilators for all the classroom heating and ventilation that are blocked up in the winter. That creates some problems with ventilation because you want those open, but they're not very efficient, so it makes sense to block them up. You have the same types of heaters here in classrooms at East Meadow. At West Street, you know, there's some issues with the brick spalling, a lot of wood windows and single pane windows. Not as many wood windows here, but definitely all single pane windows here at East Meadow. Undersized gyms with flooring issues, and then of course the boilers and all the HVAC equipment is in need of upgrading. So kind of again, starting back at the PDP, we were looking at 2 possible sites and 2 possible grade configurations, both a pre-K through 3 and a pre-K through 6. Looking at all those various options, we came up with 7 potential solutions. As Alan mentioned, one of them was just bringing West Street up to code. And that the MSBA wants to see if that's even an option that should be worth pursuing. So they want to see that on the table. Here we kind of use this matrix to evaluate kind of the pros and cons of each project, green being more beneficial and red being, you know, not so good. Looking at, you know, is phasing going to be required during construction? How many schools will the district have to maintain going forward? And then certain items that impact costs. Are there high hazmat costs at the site? A new well or septic required if we do construction at that site? And in March, the school building committee decided to narrow the seven options down to three options, all of the East Meadow site. As you can see, there's just much more green over here than on the other side. That's kind of the broad overview way of evaluating it. But mostly it came down to that there was a lot of improved staff sharing that could happen on this site, that it made much more sense for both parents and the district to have all the students here on one campus shared with the junior senior high school. Of course, costs came into, were carefully considered as well. These are the costs for the seven different options. We have both the construction costs, the estimated project budget, which involved all the costs beyond construction. Then, as Alan mentioned, the MSBA is going to pick up part of that tab, so what is the district portion of that cost? And then we also broke down the cost on a project budget cost per pupil, just to kind of get a sense for, you know, how efficient the new project would be. Again, with the final three that were being evaluated, all at East Meadow site, we have two options in the $40 million range and one option in the mid-$30 million range. So looking at those three options in more detail, that was the handout that I believe most of you guys have. We evaluated the pros and cons in a little bit more depth, had a couple more meetings with the school building committee, really looking at the benefits and the pros and cons of each different option. In May, the school building committee went with option number five, which was a ad reno at this site for a new pre-K through sixth grade school. They really felt that this site offered the ability to leverage shared staffing, especially between, you know, those age groups, the pre-K through six. That right now there's some teachers in third grade down at West Street and fourth grade here, and coordinating between those is very difficult, especially in the compound with music and art and special education. And so having pre-K through six all at one site made a lot of sense. It also made a lot of sense financially in terms of, you know, maintenance costs and site upkeep. Importantly, it'll be one 21st century building for all pre-K through six. There are some concerns with the school building committee that if we just did a pre-K through three school, students would have these great facilities and be introduced to this new technology, and then when they go to fourth grade, all of a sudden that goes away. And so this has a little bit more parity across those grades. Because half of the project would be a renovation, the MSBA has they give you bonus credits if you jump through certain hoops. So one of those is that if you renovate an older building, they will increase your reimbursement rate a little bit. So by renovating this school, we would be increasing our MSBA reimbursement rate by about 2.5 percentage points. So that, again, that brings the dollar factor for Granby lower, and you get more school for your dollar. And then again, the cost per pupil served is the lowest of all of the options that we evaluated. We wanted to quickly go into, you know, what will be provided in this new school. This is a graph showing the amount, the square footage of classroom space at West Street, under core academic, and the classroom space at East Meadow in red here, so just over 20,000 square feet of classroom space between those two schools. The new school would see about that same amount, a little bit more, because we have larger classrooms, especially at the pre-K through second grade level, which we'll get to a little bit later. But you can see special education is a little bit smaller than both schools combined, but will be much more efficient. It will be sprinkled throughout the school, will be better distributed, and easier for teachers to use, not segregated to a basement for one wing of the building. And then you can see in some areas like dining, you know, we don't need two dining rooms and two kitchens, so that space was able to be a little bit more efficient than both schools combined. Like I said, administration is woefully undersized now at both schools, so the new school would be adequately sized for a 3K-6. This is the same numbers just in a table form, but going down to the total. So the new project would be a total of 72,400 square feet, give or take, with about half of that being the renovation of this building and about half of that being the new construction to the south of here. This is the, again, very early development feasibility study proposed site plan. Some critical factors that we were working towards was having a separate bus drop-off and separate car drop-off and parking loop. And really kind of improving the safety on the site, improving site circulation, improving traffic flows, hopefully also helping the high school traffic flows as well, a little more clarity on the site. So we have new bus drop-off here, new car parking here. The ability to, one potential is to have two different playground areas, one oriented more towards the pre-K through two and more oriented towards the 3-6. We're looking at a fully accessible playground the parking, we wanted to include the same amount of parking that's at both East Meadow and West Street right now. So I think on the site we have something around 350 parking spaces, so plenty of parking for that larger school and for school events. And hopefully community use, which is a big part of what this building is about, is a resource for both the students and the community. So this is the proposed site plan. Again, very early at the feasibility study stage, but looking at space adjacencies and classroom sizes. Right now, this is the existing East Meadow footprint right here, and then we're proposing a new addition to the south, basically right out these doors here. So you can see for the existing footprint, we tried to keep all the structural walls where they are as much as possible, really trying to cut costs and be as efficient as possible with that renovation space, but still opening the building up a little bit more than it is now. Creating clusters where these grades can have kind of a smaller sense of community within the larger school community, and often within those clusters centered around special education or breakout rooms, so that teachers can very easily pull a few students out, meet with them, maybe combine classes and meet in this larger common area. We've also proposed a new courtyard where the existing library is, bringing some natural ventilation and daylight into the center of the school. And moving the library, which is undersized, to what's now the gym, which is a perfect size for a pre-K-6 library. So that switch worked out really well. And then to the south, we have a new administration wing right in front, really improving security with a nice eyesight towards the parking and bus drop-off. A new full-size gym, again, that we hope will be part of the community use part, a full-size high school gym. A new larger stage than we have here. And then mostly pre-kindergarten through second grade in this new addition portion. And again, with much larger classrooms at that age group, you know, students moving around from station to station need a little more square footage, especially at that pre-K and kindergarten level than what we have now. So, you know, community spaces, classroom sizes, really trying to integrate the special education spaces and improving the safety and kind of the function of the building. We can come back to this later if there's more questions on it, but just wanted to emphasize again, we're at the very beginning of the feasibility study. We're going into schematic design. That's when we'll be reaching out to a lot of the district heads that are here tonight and making sure that we're going down the right path, that any requirements that you have get incorporated. Because what we're shooting for is that reconciled cost estimate at the end of schematic design. And that's the big kind of dollar figure to keep in mind as we go forward. And that's when the budget gets locked in by the state, and that's when, you know, that the town will vote on whether to approve that budget and that project or not. And so we have a lot of work to do in schematic design to try and get that cost estimate as accurate as possible, even at that early stage.
I just have a quick question. Could you go back to that previous slide?
Sure.
Where is the cafeteria, and will there be like a stage area or auditorium? I can't read it from far away.
Yes, it's okay. So right now we're considering keeping the cafeteria where it is right now. It would be, of course, fully renovated, but the space is actually about appropriately sized. So the benefit of that is that with the new school, you would get two different stages. We would keep this platform for smaller presentations and smaller performances, and then you get a new full-size stage off of the gym in the new portion of the building down here to the south. So the kitchen stays where it is, but it's, you know, fully gutted and all new equipment, and then the cafeteria and stage here stay.
And that would be also a music room too, is that correct?
The new stage we're going to have as function as a music room, with some folding doors that will be acoustically, you know, dividing the gym and the music room. So we're looking for efficiencies. You know, we're trying to keep the square footage as low as possible while still accommodating the new school. That was another reason why they're trying to keep the cafeteria and the kitchen as the same place as they are now. You know, so cost is always in the back of our head, but at the same time, we want to make sure that this new school functions well into the future.
How much lower on an annual basis are the operating costs are under option 7 compared to, let's say, option 6?
Well, it's a very tough question. it's a very good question. In general, where we've renovated existing schools that have stayed the same footprint, we have seen it vary wildly even within that parameter. So that some schools, their energy costs in particular have gone down because, you know, we're insulating better, we have new windows. Whereas another school we did, their energy costs actually went up because we were ventilating the school to the point where it should have been ventilated. So they were saving energy by not letting any fresh air into the building in the winter time. So they were saving energy, but, you know, probably not the healthiest indoor environment.
Is that what you mean by operating costs, or do you also include
sharing? No, you're saying option 7, lowest annual operating costs. I'm asking how much lower on an annual basis, let's say, compared to option 6. Option 6 is the cheapest, option 7 is the most expensive, so what I'm trying to figure out is what's going to be the return of savings of operating costs for makeup business.
Yeah, I think our option here that we've sort of identified as a preferred option is somewhere in the midpoint. And operating costs can include sharing resources, sharing maintenance costs, sharing, and, you know, bringing down energy.
All right, well, what's your take on how much is the savings of the operating cost for option 7?
I can't say that I have that answer.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
But if you're willing to sort of help out over the summer months, you can probably help us drive some of that.
I'll help out by assessing what you may input.
We've got a sweaty room that we can bring you to, and you can sort of run the numbers for us.
Right, so option 7 is the all new pre-K through 6, which is the most expensive option. And this was kind of the in-between to address the whole pre-K through 6 population while still keeping the project costs as low as possible.
Are we going to make this information available, you know, in a Dropbox or anything like that? Because it is hard to read, I understand that. We don't have plans drawn up. You can certainly come up later after the meeting and ask questions, but
definitely
this information we're going to try and make available to use to...
Yeah, we're also going to try and put it on the school
right.
website as well.
Yeah, so there will be a page developed and made live probably within the next week on the school district's website. Put out a Connect Ed call as well as a tweet to let people know that it's online.
And if there are other questions like this one here where we don't have an answer, we're going to write it down. We're going to continue to look at it. Because there may be other questions that we feel tonight that hopefully we'll have answers to, and in some cases we may not.
I know my committee is very interested in your answer.
Right. So we'll take that as a note, and we'll work through that.
Thank you.
Sort of in conjunction with that, between 6 and 7, if East Meadow has no improvements, as a town, what are we looking at as far as the new building with pre-K through 6 needing improvements against a newer pre-K to 2 versus East Meadow not being touched? Did I word that correctly?
I'm not sure.
How much, what are we looking at as a town? I guess maybe I don't know how to pose the question. If we don't touch East Meadow, and we build a new West Street here, how quickly will East Meadow deteriorate and we'll be back at the same problem? Is the question.
That's a very good question. And in terms of the building finishes, they are holding up better than they are at West Street. Our consultants that came through are electrical engineers or mechanical engineers. They thought that the status of the two buildings was about equal. So really, in terms of all of the, you know, the stuff behind the ceiling and in the boiler room, is about the same. You know, needs replacement as soon as possible. In terms of the finishes, it's standing up well. You know, certainly there are inefficiencies with how the building envelope and the windows and the glazing, but you know, it's about 20 years younger. We see in about 10 years, this building would look very much the West Street. And that was part of the issue with this option number six, was that we were initially interested in the idea of having a new pre-K through three school that was somehow connected to this building. So that, again, we could have one administration wing in front, you know, maybe try and share some resources that way. But it's just, as soon as if we connect to this building, then we have to bring it up to code.
Okay.
And there's a lot of issues in this building in terms of accessibility and then if you fix accessibility, then you trip the need for sprinklers. And then if you bring in sprinklers, then pretty soon, you know, you should start thinking about renovating the building as a whole. So if we did a new pre-K through three, it really couldn't touch this building at all,
right,
which was a big factor in going towards number
five. Yeah, that's part of the rationale for including this as part of the overall project. We felt that for a marginal increase, we could take care of over half of the school population up through grade six. The rates, the bonding rates are still relatively low, so we thought we could leverage that. The per pupil cost as it relates to the building construction cost would be about, it would be significantly less by including this rather than just building pre-K through three. And I think that was up on one of the financial slides. So there were a lot of reasons for having this be part of the number one project. So.
So I'm getting with the red outlines and stuff that option five is the one we're targeting, which I think is fantastic.
Yeah.
But when we have a brand spanking shiny new school, because I'm convinced we're going to do it this time, when it happens, do we leave room so that we're not confined? Will we still be able to take school choice students in? Because now we're going to be back to the point where people are going to want to come back to Granby instead of going out of Granby. So do we have, is the room in place? Are we going to instantly be undersized because people are going to want to come here?
The real answer is yes.
yes, we're going to be undersized, or yes, we're going to be
yes, we can take school choice.
Fabulous.
But we can't build a school for school choice.
Right. No, I get it. But, I mean, we want to have the room to be able to do it, or get people to move back.
We'll still be looking for school choice.
Yeah.
And I think we'll have a very attractive option for pre-K through six. And just to kind of put in a good word for our school committee and superintendent, they're really kind of doing a good job. They're really thinking about what we need to do long term for all of our schools. So we're really starting to move in the right direction.
Can't we just say yes today and like get on with it?
You might have 2/3 here today.
I guess I'm just feeling a little bit concerned that we're choosing that option over the option seven, and for $4 million, are we going to in 10 years be sorry?
If we did not choose option seven?
Yeah. I'm just thinking, it's $4 million. The difference is small, and in 10 years, I don't want to be annoyed.
Well, one of the big differences on that one that was in one of the fine print that didn't go over. So option seven, right? In terms of the Granby share, doesn't look like that much more than option five.
Right?
Is that what you're saying? A significant impact on option seven is that with a school of this size, that's all new, and if we maintain East Meadow and use that for something else, that the town would be required to develop a sewage wastewater treatment plant on this site to handle both that new school and the junior senior high school. And so we were concerned about that in terms of cost, because that was about another $1 million of building that. But then it's also an ongoing cost of basically having someone full-time hired to maintain that sewage treatment plant. So that that was part of the process that we learned in between submitting the preliminary design program and where we are now, submitting the preferred schematic report, was doing some of the research and talking to DEP and really trying to understand where that cutoff happens and why. So I'd say that played a significant role, and then, you know, among other options, but that was a significant factor in that.
So will our sewage plant need to be developed when someday, or my grandmother, that we're at high school, and we won't even have that?
You'll have to renegotiate with DEP, but it all depends on what that population at that high school is. The septic systems that are here now were designed for a certain size population, which is actually much larger than what's at the site right now. So we're still, this is a process that's still going with DEP. We haven't reached a final conclusion with them yet, but you know, it's likely that we will be able to use the existing septic field here for this project.
Not necessarily moving forward.
And whether they'll be able to use that existing septic system over the senior high school later.
Question back there?
Yeah, I just have a question about, you know, I'm newer to Granby, and I'm going to have kids in the school systems in the near future. But I think one thing that I like to see, I'm not sure if it was ever put out there, but, you know, we have a school that's 75 years old and 50 years old. So the cost just to maintain those schools over the years from the taxpayers has essentially been wasted money into just maintaining them because of the older structures, what's put into them. So when it comes to these options and such, we talked about data that the other gentleman was speaking of. I mean, there's got to be some type of ROI with having a new structure here when it comes to the overall maintenance into the buildings. So there's got to be data that we have somewhere in this town of what we put into these buildings throughout the years, 5, 10 years, of what that money could have already been used towards something new. Right?
Right, yeah. But I think that's a good point. I mean, it's important to maintain the schools as they are. The MSBA is examining that as well. So one of those extra reimbursement points is on how well your schools are being maintained as a town. But I think it's a very difficult question, because what you don't want to see is some of those larger, you know, failures of, you know, the water at West Street not working, or the wells giving out, or something that has a big price tag on it, which it seems like we're getting close to.
Just a question about option 7. It's going to be a brand new school through 6th grade. Now, the existing East Meadow School, if they decide to use it for town offices, is it also going to have to be renovated and brought up to code if we move town offices to that building?
The West Street School?
No. We're going to move town offices to this current building. Will that mean that this building will have to be brought up to code with sprinklers and everything you mentioned?
It's likely. Yeah.
So that's an added cost right there.
And that would be entirely foreign to town, not part of the MSBA project.
I have another question, and this pertains to the septic. And Mark,
yes,
you would probably know this. Am I correct in that there's going to be discussion of a sewer line in the area?
What was the question, Karen?
I thought that there might be some talk about a sewer, not septic. I thought that was coming up relatively soon.
We voted, Select Board voted not to put the sewer project on the June town meeting because we didn't have enough time to get people informed and be able to make an informed decision. What we plan to do is keep the committee that we've got appointed going. They also might add on the charge looking at water for Five Corners. And so exploring that option. But it's definitely less expensive if we're able to keep the septic here. Because as I think Christian was saying before, you have to put in something, it even sounds expensive, a sewer, what is it, a wastewater treatment facility. And that, even that, just having that, it costs a lot to build, but it's also expensive. We have, I don't know if it's actually what they call a treatment facility or not, but we have to pay $50 a day to people who are on the sewer lines. We have to pay $50 a day to have it inspected. So that doesn't go for the taxpayers, but it goes for the users. So to put in one of these wastewater treatment plant things, $1 million, $1.2 million, we'd really prohibitively expensive. And if we have a septic system that's working, that's the best thing.
Maybe
jumping the gun, but what is the plan for the sewer while the renovation is happening?
That's a great question.
Like, if we go option five.
Right.
kind of wondering when it
right. And again, this is early in the process still to be vetted out, but the rough idea is that construction would start out here in the spring of, let me go to actually where I was going. So the spring of 2017. So construction would start to the south of here, and school would still be in session here.
The kids would stay at West Street.
And the kids would stay at West Street. And then over that summer break, our initial idea is that they would come in, they would renovate this space in particular, the cafeteria and the kitchen. So that when the students come back in September, they would still be here at East Meadow, but they would have a newly renovated cafeteria and kitchen. The reason why we're doing that is there's not quite enough time to get enough construction done out there, we think. So we still have to juggle that. And then at some point, perhaps at winter break or maybe earlier, the East Meadow students would move into the new portion that's done to the south of there.
Okay.
Okay, West Street would still be in session.
Gotcha.
The contractors would move into this space, renovate the entire rest of the school, and then in the fall of 2018, everybody would come up and use the whole project. That's the rough idea. The purpose there was to try and avoid the use of modular classrooms, both because it can be disruptive to the students, but also that's another cost that the state will not reimburse you on. So it really adds to the town's cost on that. So, and we also don't want to make it too complicated for the contractor, because then that will increase the construction. So trying to keep it as simple as possible and not use modulars, that's our rough thought for now.
Option six is
less expensive as a total project because it's only pre-K through three, so it's a smaller building and therefore has a lower overall cost, project cost than
you mean the 13 to 14 million compared to 15 to 16 million.
Correct.
Just to make sure everybody understands, I think that the slide might have been misleading. We narrowed things from seven options down to three options, but option
five
has been chosen. So it's okay to keep asking questions, but I want people to understand that it's option five. There's not a, at this point, the ship has sailed to the end of the day.
And option seven, we'll start again, we're just open discussion. Option seven, the structure we're currently sitting in is projected to be possibly town administrative offices. And option five, and actually none of these options, nothing is mentioned about West Street. What is going to happen with the structure?
So it's a good question. We've talked about it. It's not our issue with the school building committee, but it is something that we need to, you know, sort of, it's certainly running through the heads of the select board in terms of what we deal with that. But it would be something that we would handle as a committee.
Yeah, Mark, it would, once the schools are vacated and not using the building anymore, it becomes a property of the town in general. And we would look at that in terms of what would be the best way to use that building. So if it were good to use it for town office, that certainly would be something to look at. You know, if it costs, you know, like $50 million to like renovate it or something like that, we'd probably sell it for scrap.
I understand.
But I guess that's the point, is that, you know, what's missing here is the tax implications for all this, and that's not anywhere. And so we're going to go on the project, and we're just going to leave this other question, which the MSBA won't pay for the renovation of the old building for town office. That's all going to become town costs at some point. How are we going to have this discussion intelligently without knowing what the plan is for that building and the cost of the building? In other words, I get you're trying to separate out all the school building committees are responsible for it. But before going to taxpayers and asking for a tax increase, it would really be nice to have the complete cost, the Granby, of everything, rather than, well, we'll slice up and we'll pretend this is the only cost. Oh, and then, by the way, there's these other costs.
So you're right.
And it'd be really nice also to have the data, the question I was asking about the savings of operating costs compared to other options, so we're having a realistic fiscal picture here.
Yeah.
We don't see that.
Well, we're not done. as I said up front, this is the third information.
Well, it sounds like you are. You say it's option five.
It's option five. That's it.
Okay. And, you are
done. Yeah. That's done.
If the question is, what are the tax implications? There have been some early work done. There's been some early work done by a member of your committee. I don't think everything's finalized. We have to make a decision. You know, we have to figure out what's the duration. Are we going to bond for 20 years, 30 years? What are the interest rates? Will we sell West Street to a developer? Will we use that to defray costs? What level of stabilization funds, which isn't our decision, it's a town decision, will be used to help defray? So there are some outstanding issues with regards to the tax increase that we have. Admittedly, we have to work. And your question is a good question. I'm glad you're here tonight because it's a good question. And, you know, I'm not going to suggest we have all the answers here. What I'm going to suggest is we're here, we're working hard, we're assessing the options, and we are very hopeful that as we move into the fall, we're going to have much more clear answers on taxes. Now, having said that, I think John's prepared to give you a sense for what some averages might be, if he's willing to do that, or you can just know that we're going to continue to work with your committee on some of this information that's important to you and the taxpayer.
But John can't have the estimate on the cost of the West Street without a decision about the West Street.
All right, point taken, guys.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Let me introduce the Finance Committee. Yeah. I'm glad to be with the Finance Committee so other people can ask questions.
Which really is why we didn't necessarily want to make this a discussion around, you know, it needs to come into play, and it's not as if we were, you know, didn't consider it, but there are some things that are outstanding. So you're right. What will we do with the West?
I think our point is that in terms of what's the coolest school, option seven, has got the most valuables and everything else, that might actually be the better decision from our point of view fiscally.
Too late.
If we had this other day. I understand. Yeah. All right,
we're going to start taking other questions. Okay.
Good job. Move on.
Because I know there was talk of moving third grade over. Can West Street sustain K through or pre-K through three for the next 3 years or so?
Yeah, we have plenty of ducks here.
No,
it's we were past. It's, if you have kids there, you know we had to make some repairs and stuff, emergency repairs. But yeah, okay. We expect that it's going to last. And things are tested regularly to make sure that they're okay.
And we can expect that. As things stand now, West Street will stay. We don't have to talk about moving our, I mean, I know there's no word moving to anyway, but we can anticipate that the way things are at West Street will stay like that for the next 3 years until this is done.
Yes.
Okay. Can I bring up something? We were talking about operating costs and how that's going to be affected. One of the things that wasn't mentioned is we're going to eliminate a lot of bus routes.
Right.
And I don't know if you've noticed, but half of the buses that pick up kids from school are empty. They're half empty. And we have three start times. We have a start time for the high school, which is wicked early, and then the middle school, and then the kindergarten elementary. So that also is, there's not gonna be three start times, there's gonna be two start times. Maybe the high schoolers can start going to school at a reasonable hour, like 8 o'clock. And we're gonna be able to send our kids to school, you know, whether they're in kindergarten or they're sixth grade at the same time. And for families, people that have kids, this is a huge deal to us.
Yeah.
It affects our daily lives. So, but I just wanted to point that out to everybody that that was thought of as well, and that cuts operating costs.
I know we need new schools, but if we have a show of hand vote again and it's voted down, what happens then?
This is when Mercier, she was our moderator, so. She'll make the decision on how the vote is taken, if that's what you're asking.
I want to know, is something going to happen even if the vote